welcome back to my channel. Today I am filming a video talking about the worst makeup launches of 2019. I think most of these I did try, so feel bad for me, obviously, because I had to try all of this terrible makeup. My life is very hard. I'm just kidding, guys, that was a joke. But I thought it would be fun to film this video so we can look back at all the horrible makeup that came out in 2019. Now, I do have some of this product, but I'm really lazy, guys, and I don't wanna fish it out. Some of them are in like bins of things that I need to like list on Poshmark or declutter or donate, or I already gave away and got rid of. So I'm just gonna throw up a picture because that's faster, to be honest. So I hope you guys are ready. If you're not, strap in, baby, and let's go. Okay, so the first thing I want to talk about, I feel like I'm like already starting off and people are going to be like, what the fuck, Karen? But this foundation, I saw so many people love it, but I hated it. I think I got the wrong color, first of all, and I think it wasn't long-lasting enough. I love long-lasting foundations. So the one I'm talking about is the ABH foundation. They launched a new foundation this year in the summertime or something like that, and everyone was so excited because it was like a dewy foundation. And I hated it. I didn't think it was long lasting. The shade I bought was a little bit more orangey, so I didn't love how it looked and the color match. And honestly, like, I need a foundation to last all day because I do a full face of makeup when I go to work, and I don't want it to wear off during the day. I don't want to come home and be like, where's my foundation? So because of that reason, I really didn't enjoy that foundation, and it was definitely one of the worst things I tried in 2019. The next foundation was the Fenty Dewy Foundation. I was so excited because I love the original Fenty foundation, the one that, I don't know, it's like the matte one. Can't remember what it's called, but the dewy one was so disappointing. Again, same as the ABH, it just did not last on my face, and I just don't have time for not long-lasting foundations. Like, I can respect people that love to do like minimum coverage and they love to do the no makeup makeup look. Like, that's totally whatever floats your boat, honey. But for me, like, I need full coverage. I need full coverage, and that did not provide full coverage, so I did not like it. Really wish I had returned it, to be honest, but oh well. I feel really bad for mentioning this brand because I believe they're a very, very small indie brand. But this summer, I received a PR package from a brand called Cloud Beauty, and I just thought their eyeshadows were so mildly pigmented that I didn't even end up putting them on my eyes because I just was like, these colors are so light, like, they're not gonna show up on my eyeballs. And I don't know, it was just, it just didn't look like it was gonna provide the level of like pigmentation that I'm used to. So I was very much like not excited about those eyeshadows. And I did do a swatch party video, so I'll try and remember to link it for you guys. But I think they are doing more than the colors they sent me, so maybe I just need to pick out different colors to try out and see what I think, because I was very unimpressed by the pigmentation of the shadows that they sent me. The next product I want to mention, this is like a recent worst product, but the Ace Beauté Vintage Dawn palette. Like, I love that color story so much. I wanted the palette to work for me so badly, but even in the look, when I filmed it for my channel, it turned out great at the end, but the process of getting there was awful, and then I've tried to use it since then, and it's just been a nightmare to blend. I'm so disappointed. I wanna love Ace Beauté. It's a brand I'm like rooting for. Their original palette, the Quintessential palette, when it first launched, had really great pigmentation. I have decluttered that since, because we didn't hear from Ace Beauté for a long, long time. Then they did the Paradise collection, which a lot of YouTubers I've seen in recent declutters, they're getting rid of those palettes because a lot of people don't like those. Then they did the Flare palette, which I did pick up to gift to a friend, but then I never ended up gifting it to them, so I still have it, but it's unused. I haven't touched it yet, but I feel like I might try it out and see. And so I haven't tried that one, but people said the formula on that was really good. And then I did buy the Oceanic palette, and the Oceanic had a decent formula as well. Ace Butte is so inconsistent. I really, really hope that in 2020 they can bring more consistency into their brand because I love the stuff they come out with. I think they have really good ideas and I would like to continue buying from them, but that Vintage Dawn palette was a bit of a hot mess. So I'm adding the Pat McGrath foundation to my worst makeup releases of 2019 because it was just a mess. That whole launch, like the delivery time was outrageous. Like, I don't really know what was going on there, but I feel like that's where like the downward spiral of Pat McGrath kind of began. And she's just had the worst luck recently, especially with that Star Wars collection. Like, a lot of people are really upset about the Star Wars collection. And then she's just been coming out with many, 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 many palettes, like back to back to back to back, which has me like side-eyeing the brand a little bit myself. But we'll see how it goes. I haven't completely like given up on Pat McGrath yet. I'm really hoping in 2020 the nosedive kind of like goes in the, like they kind of like, you know, pull out of the nosedive that they're going through right now. But the foundation was ridiculous. Like $75 foundation, like two really expensive brushes. Like that whole foundation system is probably the most expensive thing I've ever bought in the makeup category. And I regret it so, so much. That was so dumb of me to buy that. But I love Pat McGrath so much. And I was like, you know what? If anybody's gonna nail a foundation, it's gonna be Pat McGrath. And I do like the foundation. I don't hate it. But is it like the end all be all of foundations? Absolutely not. And for that price point, yeah, I expect it to kind of like, you know, I don't know, take me out on a date or something like that. But yep, definitely was just like an overall really bad experience with Pat McGrath when it came to the foundation. The next palette I want to mention as one of the worst makeup launches of 2019 was KKW's collab with Mario, round two. I don't know, see, this is the thing, like sometimes I just like buy things because I'm like, oh, I love Makeup by Mario. Like, yeah, the palette looks like dust, but obviously like it's gonna be good. Don't worry, like just buy it. And I of course just like bought it and I hated it. I used it in a video. I think it came out over Vlogmas. I'll try and remember to link it for you guys, but it was such a bad palette. The pigmentation is like so dismal. And yeah, if I could give you guys advice, I would say honestly, stay away from that palette. It's such a waste of money. You don't need it in your life. Okay, the next palette, I haven't filmed a video on this one yet, but I have to say one of the worst makeup launches of 2019 is in my mind the Conspiracy. Which one is it? Yeah, the Conspiracy palette by Jeffree Star and Shane Dawson. So I was originally not planning on picking it up, but I ended up being at the Mall of America, oh, like the week after the weekend where they did their meet and greet, and the Morphe store at the mall still had the palette. So I picked them up there, and the Conspiracy palette, I wanted to love it so badly, but there's so many hit and miss shades in that particular palette. I do want to film a review on the palette, but I'm also like, am I going to contribute anything to the world by doing a review on it? Let me know if you guys want me to review it, because I would love to share my thoughts, but I don't know if like people still care. Like, I don't know, but I know that they will eventually restock it. So I guess maybe for those people hoping to grab it on restock, enjoy seeing my thoughts on it. But honestly, like you guys know, I'm a Jeffree Star Cosmetics fan. And I just feel like the palette is so inconsistent. Some shades perform really well. And then some of the other shades are awful, awful, awful shades. And then it's like, I don't know. You know what I mean? I don't think you should go out of your way to get it. Like, if it's easy for you to get it, you know, feel free to do that. But if you have to, like, get up at 6 a.m. to go to the mall on launch day or when it's re-released to pick it up, I would say definitely avoid it. It's definitely, definitely overhyped and you don't need it. You really don't. The next palette I want to talk about is the Rustic Glam palette by Kristen Dominique. This one really kind of hurt because actually, just Kristen Dominique's brand in general, like I really like the Latte palette, I really like the Lemonade palette, but everything after that has been very meh, and like all her palettes are like almost there, but then there's like something that's not quite exactly what I wanted, so it's not as perfect. So I bought her Berries and Cream palette, which again, I don't love that particular palette, and then I bought the rustic glam and I just did not enjoy using it. I filmed a video with it and then I tried to use it on like a work day and it just wouldn't blend and the pigmentation, and I don't know, there's times where I love her formula and then there's times where I'm like, this sucks. Like, it's so like chalky feeling, and sometimes it's like when you try to blend it, the formula just like moves around and it's like horrendous. So after that bad experience with Rustic Glam, I literally told myself, like, no more buying Kristen Dominique. Like, even her Celestial Storm palette was so tempting and it looked so beautiful. And even the other day, it was on sale for like 40% off on her website over the holidays. And I was like, Karen, absolutely no. Like, you don't even like the formula. Like, stop buying shit just to buy shit because the color story appeals to you. That's not a good way to spend your money. So, I'm just gonna like take a back seat when it comes to Kristen Dominique's line because I love her concepts, but I always feel like they're just almost perfect but not quite there for me. So yeah, I'm okay with just sitting on the sidelines and observing that particular brand. So the next palette I want to talk about is the Huda Neon palettes. Oh my gosh, those were so horrible. I was so excited when Huda decided to do these neon palettes and I just thought they were so revolutionary for the Sephora market, and I bought all three of them when they first launched, and I decided to do a first impressions video because I got them and I wanted to get a video up as soon as I could, and I just struggled through the whole thing. Now there are a lot of YouTubers that do really enjoy the neon palettes and I'm just not one of them, and that's okay. Like, that's totally okay. If it's something that appeals to you, you guys should definitely feel free to check it out yourselves. But as far as my opinion and my skill level, I just couldn't make them work, and I deeply regret buying those palettes. Okay, another palette that I thought was one of the worst palettes was Urban Decay's collab with Game of Thrones. Now, I did pick it up because I love the idea of collabing with a TV show like Game of Thrones, and I haven't actually seen all of the Game of Thrones. We recently bought the whole series on iTunes, so I've been watching it, and now I feel like I understand more of the show and the characters and stuff like that, which makes me think even more about the collaboration and how badly Urban Decay interpreted the whole thing. And then I just thought the formula wasn't that great. Like, I haven't bought anything Urban Decay in a long time, and it's for good reason because every palette I tried in 2019 was a disaster. I think there's a few more palettes I'm going to mention in my list of the worst makeup of 2019, but that Game of Thrones palette was gnarly. The next palette on here is the Stila After Hours palette. Now, again, Stila is a brand I haven't bought anything from in a long, long time. They've just never really appealed to me. I know their liquid lipsticks were like a huge deal back in the day, and then their glistening glows and glittering glows and stuff like that were a really big hit in like 2017, 2018, but I think it's kind of all slowed down for them. So when they came out with these two big palettes that kind of low-key look like Pat McGrath palettes, I was very intrigued and I picked one of them up just to swatch and play with, and oh boy, was I disappointed. Those palettes were so hard to use. The shimmer shades were so patchy and crumbly and just did not foil beautifully on my eyes. And I just like hated every second of it. So I swiftly returned them because they were very expensive. And even though I'm always like rooting for these brands to do better, especially brands that have space in stores like Ulta and Sephora where consumers can reach them much more quicker than like indie brands, like it kills me that they don't thrive. You know what I mean? So yeah, that palette was so bad. It was so bad. Okay, so the next palettes I'm going to mention are the BH Cosmetics Zodiac series. So I was trying to be like super positive about the Zodiac series and I bought a few of the palettes and then I just kind of gave up on them. They were starting to get to be too much, and BH Cosmetics in general was kind of a fail for me in 2018 because I bought way too much of it, and now I'm trying to get my reins back and just like relax and take a step back from them in 2020. So I'm not saying they are bad brand or anything by any means. A lot of their palettes are really very good for the price point, and they have some beautiful, beautiful palettes, like face palettes. They have some good lip products, brushes, things like that. You can buy a lot of stuff on their website. But for me, I just need to take a step back, and I actually sold all of my Zodiac palettes because it's just too much. Like, the shades are so interesting. Like, some of the shade choices were very like meh. I really like the Capricorn palette. That's the one I use the most, but I have so many neutral palettes. I have the ColourPop Brown Sugar palette, so I couldn't justify keeping the Zodiacs, and I feel like there's so much extra wasted space and just like a plethora of reasons not to keep them. So for that reason, I definitely feel like they were one of the worst purchases I made in 2019. And I feel like a lot of people had a lot of really negative things to say about those palettes. So I feel like overall, they were just one of the really bad launches of 2019. It had a lot of potential. Everybody was rooting for those palettes. But I feel like just with the shape they chose and the color schemes, BH really fucked up that whole series. Okay, another horrible purchase of mine in 2019 was the Tarte High Tides and Good Vibes palette. Who remembers this palette? It had such cute packaging, and I honestly don't know what really possessed me to buy it. I think since Tarte was doing so many green and blue shades in 2019, it really made me like do a double take, and that palette was just horrible. Like, it had these massive pressed glitter shades in the middle of it, and it honestly looked like kid makeup, so I'm really, really not sure why I bought it, but it definitely got decluttered with a swiftness, and I'm pretty sure it's on sale now. Like, you can definitely get it on sale, but I wouldn't recommend it because it's still Tarte. Like, you can, you know how they say, like, you can take like some kind of barn animal and dress it up and it's still gonna be like a pig. Like, if you take a pig and put lipstick on it, it's still a pig. Like, it might be the fanciest pig in the world, but it's, you know, call a spade a spade. I can't remember. Anyway, whatever the analogy is, it's like you can dress it up and turn it around and try to make Tarte seem like Pat McGrath, but at the end of the day, it's still Tarte. It's still the level of Tarte. And yeah, I'm questioning my sanity when I think about the fact that I bought that palette. So if you guys have been watching me for a while, you guys know how much I love Anastasia Beverly Hills. And I used to be a huge collector of their palettes. I still kind of am for the most part, but I've definitely learned to let go. And one of the palettes I really regret buying from Anastasia this year was the Riviera palette. I think it was one of those palettes where I got really excited that ABH was finally doing color, so I picked it up, but I don't know if it's just like one of those palettes that they produce too quickly, but I don't feel like the quality of the Riviera is the same as, for example, the Jackie Ina palette. The Jackie Ina palette has that formula that's buttery and blendable, and the shimmers like foil very beautifully. Like, it checks all the boxes that I know and love when it comes to ABH, but the Riviera palette, I feel like, was not created to the same quality standards, so I definitely want to try it out a few more times, and then after that, if I still feel like I'm not getting the right amount of work out of it, I'm gonna declutter it because I don't have room to keep stuff that I don't love 100% in my collection. So many eyeshadow palettes, oh my goodness. Okay, so number 15 is the Urban Decay Naked Reloaded palette. Now, this is again another one that has me questioning my sanity because I am not a neutral girl anymore. Like, I love putting neutrals on, like this palette today. I'm playing with the Juvia's Place chocolate palette and it's pretty neutral. But the Urban Decay palette is like the basic B of palettes, right? And I started off with the Urban Decay Naked palette. Originally, I still have my Naked palette somewhere in my collection. It's such a great workhorse palette, and I'm so bummed that Urban Decay discontinued it and then replaced it with such a shitty freaking palette. Like, the pigmentation was eh, and then the shade range was very eh. It basically looks like the ABH Sultry palette, and it's like, well, why did you make a palette that looks exactly like the Anastasia palette when you know Anastasia has bomb quality? So, I don't know. It's just like, ooh, that was so disappointing. Like, this is the Naked palette. Like, it's iconic. And then to be replaced with the Naked Reloaded was just, I feel like a slap in the face to the original Naked palette. Okay, the next eyeshadows that I totally regret, and I definitely feel like it's the worst eyeshadows of 2019, are the Love Luxe Beauty Hybrid Shadows. Now, I did show those in a video, I think a few videos, but definitely in that video I did with Amy Loves Makeup, where we talked about makeup that we bought that made us feel like a clown, because that formula was a hot mess. Like, it was so crumbly, and the shadows looked like the shadows from the Huda Beauty New Nudes collection, which is what really like drew me into purchasing them, especially because I was like, ooh, it's an indie brand, like, let me try it. But their glitter in that particular eyeshadow formula was just like chunks of white glitter, so it would like get everywhere, and I totally listed it on my Poshmark and somebody actually bought it. So whoever you are out there that bought those shadows, I hope you are enjoying them. I definitely didn't try to hide the fact that I hated them, but somebody wanted them, so I'm happy they're off to a new home. But I just was so terrified by the size of those glitters and the fact that they got everywhere, I never even got around to putting them on my eyes. So that's that. Okay, I feel like I've talked about so many eyeshadow palettes, so I'm gonna throw in one lip formula that I didn't love, and that's the ColourPop Just a Tint lip formula. So I picked up some shades from the Just a Tint line when they first launched, and I was really rooting for me to like them because I thought it was such a great idea. Like, it's a chubby lip pencil, I could carry it around in my purse, and it looked like they were gonna be like hydrating, but honestly it felt like one of those formulas where the more I put on, the less it hydrated my lips, and it honestly felt like it was really drying out my lips, which is not the goal for me with something like that, a formula like that. Like, if I'm gonna use a balm, I want it to be hydrating, and I didn't love it. So I definitely feel like those were some of the worst products that ColourPop launched in 2019. The other palette I want to talk about is the Viseart Koi palette. Now, I'm always rooting for Viseart because I feel like they are such a cool brand, but their shimmer formula just does not agree with me. And the Koi palette had such beautiful shades, and so many YouTubers were raving about the Koi palette, and it made me want to purchase it, so I did. And once I tried it, I just did not like it at all. So to me, it was definitely a terrible makeup product, and I won't buy any Viseart palettes with their shimmer formula because I just know it doesn't work for me. So there's no point buying any of their palettes that have glitters in them. I like their matte palettes, but I've also decluttered my Viseart mattes because I used to have 4 of their matte palettes, and now I just have the 2 neutral ones because I didn't really find myself reaching for the other 2. So just to kind of make room in my collection, I did declutter those, but the shimmer formula is not good. I don't like it at all. Okay, so the next product is the Milk Sticks. These are like these blush sticks that they came out with. I'll put a picture here for you guys, but I really like the idea of them. I was so excited to pick them up, and they were just not good. And it was so funny because, again, I mentioned them in my video with Amy Loves Makeup, and my friend Allie, who is actually from Fargo, and she is like very minimal in her makeup purchases, and she uses up the stuff she buys and things like that. So I really admire her and her opinions because I feel like she's not one of those people like me that just buys everything. Like, her collection is very curated and everything has a place and a place for everything kind of person. And she even commented on the video saying like she didn't like the milk stick. So I was like, okay, I'm so glad that Ali said it, because I was like, I'm out here on this island by myself where I'm the only one that doesn't like these blushes. But she actually said the very same thing that I said, is that by the end of the day, they were like everywhere, and it felt like your whole cheek was like this blush color, and they didn't quite ever set. So I'm definitely decluttering those from my collection, and I was very, very disappointed with that purchase. Now, the next product I'm gonna mention, I feel like I'm gonna get canceled because everybody was talking about these in their favorites video, but something that I think was a terrible launch in 2019 are the Cover FX blushes. I honestly don't get the hype with them. I have one bronzer shade and one blush shade, and I swear to you, neither of them blend to my liking. Like, the blush shade, it's okay, but I can't justify that price point when there's brands like e.l.f., Juvia's Place, ColourPop, Those are like my favorite blushes, actually, are the affordable ones. Milani, like, I have so many great blushes from the drugstore, and then people are like, oh, buy this like $30-something blush, and I just think it's so overhyped. And then the bronzer, I feel like I never really loved the shade. I don't know, is it just me? Like, I've never seen any tanner, dark skin people talking about the CoverFX blushes. It's all my light skin friends that talk about how amazing they are. And I personally feel like it's a huge, you know, hole in their line where they made all of these blushes that are geared towards lighter skin, and then maybe like one or two that's for like tanner and deeper skin tones. And it's really quite the bummer, because it really shows that they're not thinking about the rest of us, which is fine. Like, there's other brands that I can shop with, but I don't know. I just wanted to say that I didn't think they were as great as everybody else seems to make them out to be, but it might just be because I don't really think there's a lot of shades geared to people with my skin tone or darker. But I also just feel like the formula isn't the greatest. So if you've been contemplating or lusting after them, I would honestly say that you're pretty safe not buying them and buying something like Nabla, Elf, ColourPop, like so many brands that make some really... So the last product I want to mention in my worst releases of 2019 are the Huda Melted Shadows. These are the shadows that have like the double side. So one side's like a matte shade and one side's like a glitter shade. And they're supposed to be like these quick and easy, like blend, 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 and tap, tap, tap products. And I just feel like, I don't know, like I like a good cream eyeshadow, but they're not all created equally. I love the ones from Cindy Grace. Those are probably my favorite ones, and they are a very fantastic price point. But when it comes to something where it's a matte shadow and you need to like blend it into your crease, and then you need to use the other side, like for me to make an eye look, I usually need at least three shadows. One to put in the crease, one on the outer corner, and one that's a lid shade. And just having two, I feel like it's not really my vibe, and I just feel like that formula wasn't the best at blending, and then the shimmery part wasn't the greatest at like staying on your lid, because I felt like it wasn't vibrant enough and more crumbly, and just not my favorite formula. So I am putting that in to my list. Okay guys, so that is it for my worst makeup of 2019 video. I'm sure there's a ton of other makeup I missed mentioning in this one, but I tried to create as comprehensive of a list as I could. In 2020, I really, really want to get better at keeping better notes on new makeup releases and things like that, because I feel like there's so much bad makeup that comes out in a whole calendar year, and it's so fun to sit here and roast all of it. So yeah, let me know if I missed anything down in the comments, if there was something that you guys absolutely hated in 2019. I would love to hear from you guys, and I will see you guys in my next video soon. Bye!